Burn
Burn
again,
again,
burn
burn
again.
ABCs.
Welcome to the Bare Naked ABCs, where we discuss every single Bare Naked Lady song from 7 to Y. And here together with me tonight are Betsy and Aaron. Welcome.
Hello, we are here together.
And also here together with us, we have Brent Henry coming to join us. Thank you, Brent.
Evening all.
Hey, Brent.
I like your hat.
Yeah, nice hat.
Another tour hat.
Nice.
Yeah, beautiful.
It's great to have you back. And tonight we're going to be discussing the song Here Together. Not the Muppet song,
Together Again.
That's different. This is Here Together.
Was there some confusion about that?
Not Here We Go Again on my own.
Here We Go Again on our own. Yeah, there we go.
Nope, this is All Together. We're Here Together.
All Together Now. All together.
No, we're not talking about the Beatles All Together Now. Nope, that's a different podcast.
Oh, Come Together. Okay.
Come Together either. No, that's a different Beatles song. There's a lot of songs with Together in it.
Yeah, didn't
Happy Together?
Tim Minchin put out an album called Alone Together, I want to say. Tim, we know you listen. Come on the show.
Maybe.
Oh, Timmers.
That would be incredible. You got to reach out to Tim.
So Here Together is off from the Tour de Force. And if you have never heard it before, here is a quick snippet.
And if I could remember to feel the sun before it's gone. And while we're here together, I wouldn't miss a second of the fun. Nothing lasts forever. You just say whatever and you change the song.
And this song was written by Jim as well as James Brian McCallum. If you don't know James Brian McCallum, he is a Canadian musician, songwriter, and music producer. Most of his work is in the music production area. He has collaborated with tons of artists. If I went down the list, you'd recognize a whole bunch of them. He's been a very busy boy. But he is also the guitarist for the Philosopher Kings and for Prozac.
Okay.
The band Prozac, not the medication.
Not like a commercial.
Is he sponsored by Prozac? I should be. My music's really depressing. I should be sponsored by Prozac.
I just heard the episode the short episode where Tracy was paying homage to yourself and Jeff there, Aaron. So I thought it was quite interesting. I never heard any of your songs. I thought it was quite interesting.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. So some people that James Brian McCallum has worked with is Nelly Furtado.
Okay.
I'm going down the list. I could say her list a whole bunch of them, but Lisa Marie Presley.
Okay.
Backstreet Boys. Shawn Mendes. And like I said, there's probably another 40 names on this list. I just don't recognize all of them. The name I don't see on here, which is kind of weird that he's like,
ladies.
Hey, come write this with me, is the Bare Naked Ladies. Oh, James Blunt.
No.
Oh, we were just singing
You're
You're
just
Beautiful.
Singing his song. Yeah,
I thought you were going to say Celine Dion wasn't on it.
Oh, yeah.
She is not on it either.
Oh.
I would recognize that name. I should hope so. At least.
Yeah, she's been around for a while.
Or Anne Murray. Those are the two Canadian names.
Yeah, I was thinking Anne Murray.
Love her.
I don't think he started that work until after Anne Murray was done singing. His page doesn't have much information on it. It doesn't even have his birth date or anything like that. He just said he was born in Ottawa, Canada.
From parts unknown.
Went to the University of Toronto.
Mysterious.
Left after 2 years to join the Philosopher Kings.
Oh, nice. Okay.
So that is all that I can find on this gentleman. So not really well known. I don't know how much of this was Jim and how much of this was James.
Mm.
Feels very Jim forward to me.
Yeah, some of it feels like
he wrote a really great song.
Yeah, that laid back vibe, whatever that he has, and some of the other songs he's done. Yeah. So I wouldn't be surprised if he's probably a good portion of it.
Definitely agree.
So all I had written down for the music is this is very George Benson 70s smooth jazz-esque.
Okay, that's not what I had written, but I kind of see where you're coming from.
Okay, what did you have written?
Dad soft rock.
And what's the defining feature of dad soft rock?
Well, dad rock is, I guess, kind of like kind of indie rock or now, I guess it probably changes. That's the thing with the generation. So dad rock now is more like the stuff I grew up with, you know, with like the alternative bands. But that's why I said dad soft rock. Cause it's a little, it's not quite as like, not quite as hard hitting, but it's very relaxed, very chill vibe for sure.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like George Benson is like Turn Your Love Around and that kind of stuff. Like,
okay.
So that, I was thinking On Broadway.
On Broadway, yeah, his cover of On Broadway.
Oh, I know that one.
But Tyler calls it yacht rock.
Okay, that's pretty close. That's dad soft rock, yacht rock. Well, because like I would argue that the epitome of yacht rock is Steve Winwood.
Ooh,
and
okay.
That is soft rock. That's so yeah. Dad soft rock. I feel like I nailed that then.
Tyler, 80s soft rock right there. Yeah.
Yeah, 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 for sure.
I think that fits. I think that it's somewhere in that category, like the meeting of those. Like I know that Hall & Oates was considered to be soft rock as well, and I could see that fitting in here as well.
No, I like the comparison to like sailing, to Steve Winwood sailing. I think that's a considering the vibe. Once we get into the you know into the music and stuff, like that's kind of the vibe he's going for.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I actually thought of driving in the summer. Actually, so I may as well tip my hand. I was going to wait for this. But Tracy, if you can load this video up and mute the audio and then play the song over it, I just want to know if you're on the same page here. See if you tell me if I'm right. You tell me if I've pegged this song perfectly or not.
I have another image for you that's similar but different, but I think we might be going the same place. Just
yeah, we might be.
Okay, let me see if I can pull this off. Why is it not sharing screen? Okay. This
technical pause brought to you by CrowdStrike.
Oh, no.
For the people that are listening, I will include that clip. And so you can try this at home and see if it works for you.
For
I
yourself.
Think that this definitely works.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you. I'm glad. Vindicated.
Well, let me throw another image.
Yeah, I want to hear Brent's.
So for me, my wife and I, we rent a cabin. We pay for we rent it by the year, so we can go there whenever we want. But it's a it's on a small lake, and in Alberta, once it gets over like you know for you guys, basically about 80 degrees, it starts getting algae, but still nice to look at. But you know, there's a beautiful deck at the back, and so usually I'm picturing Canada Day, like on the 1st of July, the like every year this area site where we are, my best friend, his wife, and other friends are there. And they literally light up fireworks over our head because the area is just in front of the beach. And, you know, just when I picture this, I picture, you know, sitting on the deck, almost like a beer commercial instead of a car commercial.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know, sitting there, you know, there's a crowd of friends around there, you know, sunshine and everybody having fun and kids are running around and stuff. And, yeah, it's just that or even just the relaxation part because, you know, like the first time we went to this cabin, we sat there with we finally got our, you know, moved everything in, got the chairs out. Sat on the deck, put our feet up. It's like, this is why we worked. You know, this is what we did. We just sit there and just look out over it.
Just enjoy it. Yeah, for sure.
Because later on, when you get towards the lyrics, later on, it's like basically, you know, like a sense that I got, you know, kind of enjoy life while you have it kind of thing. Like, where you're like, you know, while the sun's shining, while you're living a good life, other song, whatever. So then that's what came to my mind.
Yeah, it reminded me of that quote from Andy from The Office. I wish there were a way to know that we were in the good days before they were gone.
Or maybe another movie, Highlander, better to burn out than fade
away.
Yeah,
there you go. Yeah. The candle that burns twice as brightly burns half as long. Yeah, but no, I it's a good sentiment, and it fits the song, and it's kind of, yeah, that relaxing kind of just enjoy things vibe for sure. Should we break it down?
I was just going to mention a couple more things. So this song was created because Jim had a pentatonic riff that was hanging around in his head for a number of years. And James Brian and he were just playing together, and Jim mentioned it, mentioned this riff, and they started talking about missing things when they're gone and appreciating them when you have them, like you guys were saying. And we can go into more about the lyrics and stuff afterwards, but then, you know, Kevin pulled out his T-Wah pedal from high school to use on this song. So yeah, that's kind of the genesis of where this song comes from.
No, this is Bare Naked Ladies.
Tracy. I love Genesis.
Peter Gabriel, we know you listen, come on the show.
Ed did point out, he says, I love getting Jim Cregan songs because I learn every time that I have to learn a Jim Cregan song, because he is so methodical with putting things together to make it sound a particular way.
Interesting.
I see Betsy's face. She has,
I got a
thoughts.
Comment, but I want to hear the breakdown first before I throw my random thought out there.
Well, let's do that. Let's have the breakdown, Aaron.
All right, let's break it down. Here Together was recorded at precisely 113 beats per minute. It is, to the best of my knowledge, in the key of A major. And it mostly it's mostly a three chord song. It's sometimes a four chord song and then very rarely a five chord song, by which I mean D, E, and A are mostly what we're hearing. But occasionally you hear an F sharp minor and you hear a B minor in the what I'm calling the bridge, the instrumental solo section. So it breaks down like this. The intro section, which is we are A changes, is D, A, D, A, which is just 4-1, 4-1 resolving. And then we go into the verse, D, E, A, D, which if you're counting at home, if you're spelling at home, spells dead. And the intro is da-da. Everything is a word here, interestingly enough, right? So verse, so that's 1-4-5-1. The chorus is D, E, A, F sharp minor, which is deaf, and then D, E, A, which Drug Enforcement Administration, we know you listen, come on the show. And then the resolution is F sharp minor to E to D, which hilariously enough spells fed. And then I think the only part that is not kind of an anagram or actual written out word is the solo section or the bridge, which is B minor to D to F sharp minor to E, which then goes back into our intro changes, D, A, D, A, da, da. So that's pretty much it. So we have essentially four sections. We have the intro, which is our A changes, D, A, D, A. The verse is D, E, A, D. That's our B changes. Chorus is D, E, A, F sharp minor, which is our C changes. And then the solo is B minor to D to F sharp minor to E. So we have the structure of the song, which is the intro, A changes, verse one, B changes, chorus, C changes, verse two, B changes, chorus, C changes. Solo slash instrumental bridge section, however you want to classify that, is our D changes, and then back to the chorus for our C changes. It's pretty straightforward. Not, you know, the most complex song, but it is interesting that they're doing quite a lot with just a few chords, because the you can tell there are different changes going on and they are actually going through them. So I think that suits the vibe that the song is going for, because we've talked about how it sounds kind of restful, right? It's very relaxed. It's not going too far. Like, there's barely much as far as minor chords. There's only occasionally going to minor, and we're pretty quickly resolving. We're staying in a kind of a 1-4-5 zone most of the time, with occasional dipping our toes into like a six minor. But it's very restful. It's very kind of relaxed, and it kind of feels appropriate for the tone.
I hope you weren't going to tell me that if you play it backwards, it's Ed is Dead or something like that.
We got a new conspiracy theory now. Sir Paul, we know you listen. Please come on the show.
Well, actually, if you reverse it, it's ad, ad, ad. So it's all these ads that Jim wants to have the song on.
Speaking of ads.
Instead of da, da, da.
Da, da, da. Yeah, that's the song in a nutshell.
Yeah, no, that was one of my comments. But the other comment I think I had when I was looking at this is just why wasn't this a single? Like, especially, I can't remember when Tour de Force came out, but it's like, why wasn't this would have been such a nice not necessarily maybe on the, you know, some of the really more, you know, the more, I want to say contemporary. I'm almost 60, so I don't listen to a lot. You know, if it's top 40, I probably don't know what it is, and I don't want to know what it is. But a lot of stuff that's there that basically, you know, but for some of the other kind, like calmer, we'll say adult, you know, oh my gosh, I'm feeling kind of old today. But, you know, almost like easy listening, because it would really fit kind of a station like that really well. Mm. Like far better, like the single, I looked it up, the singles that were released were Flip, Good Life, New Disaster, and Big Backyard. I gotta be honest, I think this is a lot better than New Disaster and probably a little bit better than Big Backyard. They like, I imagine the band likes Good Life more than some people like it or whatever, but Flip, you know, Flip's a pretty good song in its own right, but like I think this would be a, would have been a good number two single rather than a
fidget
not a single.
So regarding New Disaster, I'm gonna have to quote from Office Space and say, yeah, I'm gonna have to go ahead and sort of disagree with you there. I like that song quite a lot. But I take your point for sure.
Yeah. It's not bad, but
it's
just
definitely it's a good feel good summer song. It would be a good tour single. I agree.
Yeah. When was, I can't remember when Tour de Force was Tour de Force was released. If it was
22?
Spring or, I remember the year. I just remember what time of year it was.
Yeah.
I think I got it for
Tracy.
Give me a second.
The repository of knowledge.
Wikipedia. The repository of knowledge.
I remember getting it for Christmas.
Consult
so
the
whatever.
Oracle. Yeah.
July of 2021.
June. New Disaster was released the 4th of... Yeah, New Disaster was released the 4th of June, 2021. This should have been the song that came out on the 4th of June, 2021.
That's it.
Just saying. You have to say that it shouldn't... The other one shouldn't have been there, but this is the one.
I'm not going to say that the other ones shouldn't have. I like the other ones as well. I would have rather seen them start off with New Disaster rather than Flip, but, you know, so be it. But I don't understand why this one wasn't released as a single. Mm-hmm. Like, this, it wouldn't be unusual for them to release a fifth single off this album, or fourth single, sorry, because Big Backyard was never released as a single. It was Flip, New Disaster, and Good Life. So this would have been a really good fourth single for them to release, and they've done four singles off an album in the past.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, they've done that since Steven has left the band in the past, so it's not unheard of for them.
Has Jim had a single, though?
I was just going to say...
That's a very good question.
I don't think Jim's had any singles, so
Jim deserves one.
Jim or Kevin have had singles, ooh, and they both deserve it.
Yeah,
yeah, especially...
agreed there for sure.
I don't want to say especially Kevin. Tilt my head hand and say
it's okay. We all know what you're thinking, Ben.
I would be less surprised if Kevin had a single versus Jim.
But true, for sure. Like it, yeah. This is
more prolific too, I think so.
Yeah, this is definitely one that I could, you know, it's a radio friendly song for sure.
Yeah.
Well, especially if you're wanting to get in with a different crowd, and so you release it and you're like, you release it to like you said, Brent, only the soft rock stations that play the old stuff, and you're like, here's something new that we haven't played before, but from a band that's releasing stuff that's a little bit different. And they play it, like, it's gonna catch some ears.
I thought you were going to suggest that they did, like, a dubstep remix of this or something.
Oh, wow.
No. Do not ruin this song. Yeah, I'm going back and looking, and I'm not, at this point, seeing any Kevin or Jim songs.
So maybe Ed would like to come on the show and explain to us. Hey,
I know.
You're Ed, in the hot seat, Ed.
Ed, we know you're listening. We know you have the answer. We would love to hear it.
It's true.
Need it from a credible source.
Mm.
But yeah, why aren't there? Why? I mean, this is an incredible song. But whatever. It has been. They do like playing it in a concert. They have played it 52 times in concert.
Okay.
Since they released
it. Yeah, it's like when I hear last summer on Earth tour or whatever, I this kind of song definitely kind of fits that vibe. So I
saw them in Calgary last year, and they played it there as well. Nice. Good.
Yeah, I think they've played it every single since 2021 in December, which is a late one to add this into, but I don't think they toured after they released this album.
This is
December,
like right
2021,
in the heart of,
they
the Backstreet Boys reunion tour.
they then have played at every concert since then.
Yeah.
So
can we get into the lyrics a little bit? Because I had a comment there. So I really like the and again, I have none of the musicality that you have, Aaron, when it comes to stuff, but I really like the additions that they made to the, you know, the first chorus is like seven lines or whatever. The second one's 10 and the third one's 10. But the additions in the second and third part of the chorus are, you know, it's really nice. I love, you know, this like stitchers from my sweater. To me, that's like, that spells like, you know, that's almost like a bad Randy Travis song or whatever. Like that would probably fit quite well, like you said, with an older crowd. So, that's so cute. You know, they can picture it.
Jim, we know you listen to Weezer.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, you totally.
Weezer who?
To it. Yeah. See, that's the thing. So for me, yeah, being an alternative rock guy, a 90s kid, I heard, like Stitches from My Sweater, They Came Undone. I mean, that's got to be a Weezer reference.
Nothing lasts forever like stitches from my sweater, they came undone.
Yeah. I mean, it's almost the line from that. Undone itself.
Die! If you want to destroy my sweater, hold this bed as I walk away.
And walk away.
Watch me unravel. I'll soon be naked.
Lying on the floor.
I've come undone.
Either that, or he's just right on the same wavelength as
could be Rivers. Cuomo. Rivers, we know you listen, come on the show.
Because the part that really got to that life metaphor that I was talking about is like that last line, you know, to feel the sun before it's, you know, feel it's while we're together, I wouldn't miss a second. Like that, you know, it's still some of the other stuff, but it's really, we're changing like the weather. It's like, you know, like life moves on, that kind of thing. And that really calls to me about, you know, hey, enjoy life while you got it kind of thing. So
one of the lines that really hits for me, because I didn't know the story of where this comes from, but now that I know the story, the line means so much more to me, is Jim's daughter Chloe was going on a trip, and she looked at him and said, "Don't miss me much."
Oh, she said that.
And he said, "You know what? I'm gonna miss you much."
You said, "Don't miss me much." But I could never hold on to you long enough. And if I...
Like, which totally I could see coming out of Jim's mouth.
Well, love to know where you found that story, because I was looking for stories on this and I had a hard time finding them. So,
when they did this album, instead of doing any specific track by tracks, what they did was Music Mondays or something like that on Instagram and TikTok, where they released little stories every Monday about a different song, and that was where this was.
Oh, cool!
I pull things out of the random places.
No, it's cool. So cool, because I was looking for something like that.
But that was the guiding line of this song, and he keeps this song to remind him to appreciate his loved ones while he's with them, which goes with the other thing that he had said just a few weeks and wrote about his most recent song on the new album, which is he wants to remember to pay attention to the things when they're gone as well. So Jim is always thinking about his family, it would seem.
Smart man.
Yeah, family man.
He also said that there is nothing like missing oxygen when you're on the bottom of the ocean.
Oxygen was getting thin, made it from the bottom of the ocean.
Yeah, I actually was curious because he talks about bottom of the ocean, oxygen getting thin. I was wondering if this was kind of maybe an allusion to the Bends. I'm not sure if specifically, I mean, we had a Weezer reference, so maybe it could be a Radiohead reference. I'm not sure, but I did kind of make that connection.
Yeah, I think he was thinking like when things aren't around, you really super miss them. And so that's what he was kind of going with.
Yeah, no, that resonates with what you said. You know, I said for myself as a retired Army guy, like so that, you know, some of these songs, like you have a lot of time to, it's what they call it, moments of fear surrounded by, you know, long moments of boredom kind of thing.
Yeah.
That's weird. So, but it's, you know, it's always nice to, when you're away like that, you always reflect on your family. And it's like songs like this that kind of bring me back as well.
Betsy, you've been unusually quiet. Would you like to give us your thoughts?
Is that unusual? It's not unusual. You guys, you know I love Jimmy. You know I love Bare Naked Ladies. You know, you know I play bass a little. And you can tell
I feel like Betsy is like has filled up the Haterade bottle tonight.
Well, let me preface this by saying, you can tell that a bass player wrote it because it's all open strings, except for a few notes, which makes it easier to sing. I get it. I had a hard time connecting with this song because it was a little, it just felt a little generic to my ear and life experience. I appreciate the message. It's kind of like that YOLO message of, you know, enjoy the YOLO is so millennial, whatever generation that is, but
hey, what's wrong with millennial
thing? But to me, it just reminded me, it was very similar to kind of the message behind Paul Chambers and Just Wait, like thematically. So at this point, just feel like he's repeating himself a lot, which is, it's still a good message. And it's kind of like different angles of the same message. And I don't want to be bitchy about it. I just feel like it's fine, but when this is a third song that sounds pretty samey to me, it feels a little forgettable. I'm sorry, Jim. I love you. Come on the show and
but you know, it's funny
or whatever.
It's funny though, Betsy. You're saying the same thing that I said for In Flight. And
oh,
like there's some of the stuff was a lot of the same stuff I message. Same, so you know what I think, and again, because I'm a little bit older than, you know, than the Bare Naked Ladies, it's like, you know what, they're starting to feel their age. That's all I can tell you. A lot of people doing a lot of stuff.
No, it's self-reflective. You're starting to feel it. Makes sense.
Yeah, that's definitely been a recurring theme. But also there's kind of one theme of like gratitude, you know, like loving life, you know. It's funny because I was thinking about that kind of memento mori of it all, and you know, I do like the optimistic kind of positive take on it, like, you know, enjoy what you have, you know, bask in the sun while you can, gather your rosebuds while you may, right? So like I dig that, and I do like this song better than Love and Life. So I actually, and especially after hearing you all talk about it, and especially you, Brent, and hearing your take on it, I think I'm going to rate it slightly higher than I was planning. But I was kind of agree with Betsy that it's still not like my favorite. And I personally prefer the more stark existential dread of New Disaster. But, you know, I'm sure everyone was expecting that from me.
I'm shocked. I'm only on episode 189, but I'm shocked.
My reputation precedes me.
I want to know, Aaron, I want to kind of thinking here, the organ that was in the this song, I think he used the same organ for the Selfie Cam Jam as he probably did in the theater, because it sounds very studio, because it sounds very similar. It's a Yamaha, but what do you know what kind of instrument it is?
Well, I'm guessing it's like just a multi-voice like synth keyboard.
Did you see the video?
I did, but I'm having trouble remembering. I could take a look, but I mean the voice of that particular organ is one that I associate with having played on Yamaha and Roland and a few other types of keyboards, Kawaii. I um Or I should say kawaii, something else. but yeah, I associate that with the quote unquote rock organ voice that you hear on a lot of these.
Right there. Oh,
yeah, that's a nice keyboard, a nice little organ there. Or that's interesting.
Yeah, because so you get the hammer. Little the I want to say pedals, but they're you have hammer the time. The bangers. I don't know.
Bangers.
Up yeah, top
bangers
like
are sausages, Tracy.
Yeah. but you have these up here on the top, like you would with stops. A key with a piano, but down below it looks sort of like an organ as well.
That's interesting. I'm not quite sure what that is, but it's an interesting. I do love kind of non-traditional keyboard instruments. Like personally, I'm a huge fan of the Mellotron, just because it's like sort of an analog synth in that it has like tape loops that it presses against playheads when you hold the key down. It's very unusual. So I'm not sure what I haven't seen this particular model before, but it is cool, and I would be curious. Kevin, please come on the show. We know you listen.
Kevin, one thing I want to say is toys.
Yeah, I am very envious of all Kevin's toys for sure.
I was going to say that I enjoyed the selfie cam jam version a little bit more than I did.
Yeah,
the
video. Had a good energy.
There's something more to it that I really enjoyed here. So
I would agree there.
Yeah, I like the selfie cam jam better, and I think the other thing about it is there's that it's a bridge. There's an actual bridge in the selfie cam jam version. Which has some different kind of stuff going on. I'm going to see if I can play that here now. Just so I don't have to I can add it in later. But yeah, there's that bridge, which sounds just incredibly different than what we're hearing during the rest of the song. And I enjoy.
So if Rivers Cuomo played a kawaii piano on a bridge.
Oh no.
Would it be the bridge over Rivers Kauai?
Oh.
Aaron, one podcast tonight.
Nice.
It hurts being this funny.
that was a good stretch. I like that one.
That's good.
Stretch Armstrong.
She limbered up for that one.
I also want to point out in something interesting we see live as well as we also see it on the selfie cam jam, which is that normally when Jim writes a song, we'll see Ed go back on bass and play the bass while Jim does the front stuff, and he doesn't. This time he plays an acoustic guitar.
That's why he did the open strings.
You don't need to.
Nice catch on that, Betsy.
Yeah, thanks.
I missed it.
So, I didn't hear him. Oh. I didn't hear him at all. I didn't hear Ed at all in this really either, too, which I thought, when you watch the selfie cam jam, he doesn't seem to be singing at all, which I thought was.
Yeah, he's kind of in the background for this one.
Yeah.
Yep.
So Tracy, Betsy had pointed out that the song was so written that Jim would be able to play mostly on open strings, which probably made it a lot easier to sing and play bass at the same time.
Oh, gotcha.
Oops. As a guy struggling to learn the drums here at times, whatever, said, hey, anything that makes a song easier is better.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, it kind of fits with the theme.
Easy going.
Simple, fulfilling life, I guess.
To that point, Brent, when you mentioned the drums, actually my favorite part of the selfie cam jam video was there's this part where it cuts to Tyler, and he's just like so clearly having a great time. Tyler's always having a good time. I wish Tyler, please come on the show.
Yeah. We listen. I also want to point out that brings up to mind to me too that you can hear the drums more in the selfie cam jam version as well.
I think that's maybe why I like it. I like hearing the percussion, getting the driving beat a little more.
I agree. Well, I'm going to kick us out just to come back in. And while,
how dare you?
While I'm kicking us out, I'm going to send our listeners to an ad. Come back in a few minutes and listen to what we give this for a rating.
We should open up a croquet park and say it's wicked good fun.
Wicked good fun. Wicked.
I missed that pun. I didn't
know.
Oh,
you'll
hear
catch
it
later.
Yeah, you'll hear it when you're editing our audio.
Okay. Betsy's like, don't make him say it again. Please don't make him say it
please
again.
Please deliver me from Aaron's puns.
Seltzer burps. So you're going to edit out something else.
Can I throw a suggestion out there? For I know, I'm not sure who, again, haven't got far forward now to know who's coming up with sort of the reading thing. But I don't know if, have you used Suns yet? S-U-N-S, not S-O-N-S?
I do not believe that we have.
I don't think we have. I would totally agree with that. I think it's cool to let the guests pick the rating unit. My moon unit. My sun unit.
Well, last week was, or 2 weeks ago was how many moons, so it makes sense that this week is how many
moon
suns.
Of my life. My sun and stars.
You're redeeming Aaron from a couple of weeks ago.
Oh, okay. I haven't heard that one yet, so I got to catch up here. What episode are you on right now? 300 and what?
Oh, geez. 335.
Oh, man. Okay, so I got about 150 to go. My goal,
condolences, Brent.
I'll try and get to the mid-200s by Christmas time. It's only, like, early in July. I might just make it. We'll see. Well, we're in Canada here, like, I'm a public servant now after I left the military, and we're now we're working 2 days a week in the office and 3 days at home. Now we're going back to where, you know, the most people are going for 3 days a week, but because I'm an executive, I'm lucky. So I get to go 4 days a week. So lead by example, but say that, what it means though, is I now have an extra 2 days per week.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
Going back and forth my commute. This is when I listen to the show all the time.
Okay.
So.
Okay.
So I'll double down.
Happy
I'll
help.
There.
Yeah.
Maybe I'll get there.
Happy listening.
But,
Suns. Aaron, how many suns do you want to give this song?
Well, it's interesting. Like I said, I mean, I'm not in love with this song, but I certainly don't hate it. It's not a bad song. I think that, you know, I think I was leaning somewhere in the three area, but again, having kind of discussed it with everyone, again, you know, kind of a little more, I think the Selfie Cam Jam version is better and that kind of bumps it up on average. I think that, you know, discussing kind of what it means to everyone, especially hearing Brent's perspective, you know, I really do like the message of the song. I think it's important. As Ferris Bueller said, you know, if you don't stop and smell the flowers, you might miss it, you know? So, I think it's important to appreciate what we have and to kind of enjoy things and take things slow every once in a while. So I'm on board with that. So that kicks it up just a little bit, but I am going to rate this song 3.5 suns out of 5, which I wanted to make sure that I rated it just slightly higher than Love and Life because I do like the song better than that one.
You know, it's interesting you said that. I never picked up on it before that Ferris Bueller says that. Mm. And then, like
towards the beginning of the film, right?
At the end of the film, if you stick through it, if you stick around and smell the flowers, then you get that wonderful thing at the end, the post-credit scene that has never been done in other movies. So, yes, stick around and smell the flowers.
Ferris Bueller, you're my hero.
The only line I remember from Ferris Bueller is after the Ferrari, whatever goes in the Porsche or Ferrari goes in the water, like, who's the U-boat commander?
Nice.
Betsy, I know that drinking the Haterade is hard to do.
I've got two.
Cheers.
But we've all had to drink it. So I'm going to ask you to do the hard thing and give us your rating.
Those tears you're trying to process.
salty Haterade. Got those electrolytes.
I think she's also trying to figure out, like, where was he going with that one?
I mean,
sometimes following my puns and knowing what I'm leading to for the next song is hard to do.
I always know where you're going, but I don't always approve of the path. But I appreciate your humor and I appreciate you, Tracy.
We all appreciate you for sure.
Love, love, love. Mwah.
Do you know what next week's song is?
Yeah, I did. I forgot it though.
What is it?
You're cheating. You're looking at the screen.
I am asking you to tell me what the song is.
No, that's
is.
Not next week. That's the one we just did last week.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. I'm going, you know, it's hard to do sometimes to make those puns, Tracy. Yeah, I got there. I got there.
What's next week's song?
Hard to do.
There you go.
It's the song that was left off the albums.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
Knowing the songs that aren't on the albums is hard to do sometimes.
That's a good one. I'll give you credit for that one.
So Betsy.
I am back.
How many times can we make it hard to do pun?
Oh, it's pretty hard to do.
I'll just leave it up to you, Tracy. Does
make the score any better?
No, leaving it up to you is an earlier song.
I mean, I skipped a couple things, but I don't. I think I'm ready to get my score. Hold on. I need to hydrate.
Cheers.
Is this going to be Betsy's first one?
No.
I would be shocked if it was one.
Middle of the road to me. I'm sorry.
It's just a question. Is it average or above average, below average, or dead average? Dead on
It's a little above dead. funny dead. Because of all the
it's not quite dead yet.
It's only mostly dead.
Not dead yet.
I think, you know, for the reasons I stated before, it's got a good message. It's just I'm just not connecting with it. I think I don't know if it's more musically because the lyrics are good and the lyrics make sense. So I don't know if it's just if it just is lacking some punch in the music, but either way, I give it a 2.6.
Okay.
Is that because there's no bass solo to drive it forward or whatever? Or
I mean, it needs some carbonation to it. It needs a little life.
Are you like an 70s soft rock type person, though?
No, I'm very much not.
That's probably part of the problem is that I think Jim hit exactly what he was going for on this. For it just isn't your thing.
Yeah.
He's thinking, what would Geddy...
I think you're thinking, what would Geddy Lee do with this?
I like to hear like a prog rock kind of version, you know, maybe in 5/4 or something like that. Yeah, then now you're talking my language.
That'd be interesting. But I want to hear from you, Brent.
Yeah,
what do you think of this?
So again, I like the song. You know, I'm using the Bare Naked ABC's measure of, you know, would it be on my playlist or not? Mm. So playlist is a 4. So I definitely have them on my playlist. So, nice. But to me, you know, I love the song, love the message, really resonate with, again, the slightly older guy. So it really resonates with me. The one thing I'd say though, is it's not call and answer. It's not you run away.
For sure.
And it's not pinch me or whatever. So that, you know, that kind of cuts it out of the top group. But, you know, I was thinking, I think I was going to land on like a respectable 4.25 suns because like I said, there's a lot of room for the other songs that I really, really enjoy. And, you know, it's more, to me, it's more respectable than some of the other stuff that I've listened to. Respectful is the wrong word. I appreciate it more than I do some of the other stuff. Sorry, my cat's demanding time here, but no, overall, like for me, the selfie cam jam boosted up even that little bit more. Mm. You know, the guys are, you know, they're having, gotta be honest, you're home, you're not going anywhere. So, you know, you're relaxed, you know, you're playing with the guys, you're doing your thing. It's a song you wrote and you really enjoy, and that comes out in that. So
nice.
And so, Betsy, I'm gonna disagree with you. I'm a big fan of like 70s soft rock, you know, George Benson, Grover Washington, stuff like that. Like I'm really into that stuff. Grew up on it and really enjoy it. And I think that Jim nailed it. Like he got what he was going for on this. Even if it's not your thing, like I think he did what he was aiming for. And for me, I like the message, and it's hitting me at a time that it's a good spot to hit me as well. But I think, you know, its placement on the album was pretty good, following up Flat Earth and then into this. So you have this kind of silly song leading into the happier song. And then, well, unfortunately, then we go into Roll Out. But so it also gets the halo effect in comparison to Roll Out right there.
There you go.
We'll disagree with that.
It hired Roll Out to stand next to it at parties.
That's right. I'm going to give this 4.4 suns.
Oh, wow. Now, Tracy, I'm going to say, just in the same way that I would not disagree with you. So you say you disagree with Betsy. I think it's totally fair. I would agree that Jim stuck the landing. He went for like that 70s soft rock feel and he nailed it. But I think it's also valid to just be like, well, that's not my jam.
Oh, you know? Totally.
It's like they're playing polka and I like heard rock and I can't leave the wedding.
I mean, no, Betsy, polka, you are country. Wrong in your opinion and your feelings.
Love you, Tracy.
Yeah. No, but But like you said, it's like you're stuck at the wedding. They're playing polka and country, which you absolutely hate. No soft rock or other stuff that you love.
Yeah.
And it's like, when's this party going to end? Or when they're going to play something.
Betsy's wondering
like
about this podcast at this point.
No, you know, following along the bass lines that were nice and everything.
Yeah, there you go.
Trying to
there's always something to appreciate. Out,
smell the flowers.
There you go.
But you know what? Maybe that's the I can't play anything other than kind of sort of the drums violently and loud, not necessarily well.
That's
but
the way to play them.
Yeah. So I don't have that same appreciation. Like, man, if he had done this, it would have sounded so much better. Knowledge of that. So it's like, oh, it works. So it's your educated view. I think that's sort of grabbing hold of you there.
That's very generous. Thank you.
Hey, to me, music is a
being
miracle.
Nice to her. Stop being nice to
yeah.
her.
Yeah. Tracy.
She's always you shitting bastard. On me.
Ah, you like it. I like it.
Hey. We're not going to make fun of fetishes.
Oh, that's right.
We don't kink shame on this podcast. That's right. But yeah, anyway. No. So, you know, that's, anyways, I want to transition out of that awkwardness, which is kind of hard to do.
Just like breaking up.
Breaking up is hard to do.
Yeah, buddy.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, buddy.
And you guys, you're breaking up. I can barely hear you. So we should probably get going.
Okay. Sorry, the podcast going through a tunnel right now.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll thank my house going
through a tunnel. Our yacht.
Our yacht's going through a tunnel.
Yeah.
Sorry, what were you saying, Brett?
Through a bridge.
No, I was going to say, we'll come out stronger and better once we get to the other
yeah,
side.
Yeah, yeah. Right. Some clarity.
Find
moment
is
of clarity.
There another side with this new stuff?
I know I'm totally on the wrong side of the podcast here to ask my question, but this one's for you, though, Aaron. So is it normal? I'll be honest. Like I said, music. I've listened to Stefan for a few episodes, and you know he just says, "No, it's just music." He just listens to it. But so to me, when I printed the in preparation for the shows, like you know, for this is what third one I think I've done now. So what I do is I'll do something I never do, which is I actually printed the lyrics and read it. And is it usual? Is it a normal sort of like you know approach where someone would like you know change the length of the chorus like that, like said from 7 lines to 10 and 10?
Not typically. I mean, it's not like super unheard of, but it is unusual. And I think, you know, that kind of meter breaking is an interesting, like, you know, element. You know, I this is going to come as a shock to longtime listeners to the show. I'm a fan of the band Radiohead. So I like when people play with rhythm. So you either like add a beat here or there, or you drop a beat, or you change the time signature maybe in the middle. Or, you know, Radiohead's very fond of actually having like a normal time signature, but it's subdivided in such a way that it sounds like it's some kind of weird abstract trapezoidal thing. So that, you know, yeah, I think it is kind of fun to see. Honestly, I do think like when I was reading the lyrics, it read more like a poem, and it kind of felt like, maybe Jim was kind of playing with the meter a little bit. And to your point, and I do think that all of the ladies have kind of this tendency to do kind of programmatic stuff. Because, you know, I think this song is clearly about, you know, kind of appreciating our time and is thinking about time. There's a good chance that was intentional, where it's like, you know, your perception of time changes as you age and like, you know, things can seem different. You know, we, you know, when I was a kid, you know, when I was 10 years old, 10 seemed like forever, you know, 10 years. And now I'm like 10 years. Oh, that happens in a flash. Right. So, yeah, I think maybe there could have been something intentional going on there.
No, interesting. But so, yeah, just it's not often that, but it's to me, it's done seamlessly. So I don't really
notice.
I never noticed that the chorus had, you know, they had three extra lines per the second and third chorus. So it was, that was interesting to see.
Yeah, that's the sign that it's well done. It's executed well. It's you're not really paying attention. You might not notice it for sure.
No, thank you for that.
You're very welcome.
Well, thank you for joining us tonight,
thanks,
Brennan.
Good to have you on.
Love this stuff. When you go to albums, I really want to come back to some of the album stuff. I'd love to come back again and talk about one of my top three favorites. They'll say, maybe you should drive. Someone else I know likes that one. So
hopefully we'll get him back too.
Yeah. Oh, great. Okay. Well, thank you very much for having me. So I'd love to come back in sometime.
Yes, thanks, definitely.
Good seeing you, Brent.
Hey, take care. Thanks, Betsy.
And Aaron and Betsy, next week we will be discussing I'm Asking You To.
Yes.
Yeah, I thought so.
Sorry. I didn't mean to break the illusion.
We had to go
illusion.
Out of order a little bit.
Yeah, we broke the fourth wall.
So, yeah, we're going to be going backwards and then we'll go forward. I don't see any mistakes until or any more skips until November, but we'll see.
All righty.
You're done.
I love everyone. That look you're doing, Betsy. Yeah, right, Tracy.
Ellipses.
Have a great night, guys.
Night.
Yep. Bye-bye.
See you next time.
Arwen Lewis Show is brought to you by Evolve Entertainment, featured on Pantheon Podcasts. And I'm Arwen. I inhabit our blue planet, but my beliefs belong in the celestial realm. I'm the daughter of Peter Lewis, founding member of rock and roll cult icons Moby Grape, and the granddaughter of Oscar-winning actress Loretta Young, and I've been part of the creative cosmos all my life. I'm a recording artist, musician, songwriter, and producer, and I am your host for The Arwen Lewis Show. The Arwen Lewis Show features in-depth interviews with the hottest indie music artists and music royalty. Listen to me on any of your favorite digital listening platforms, particularly from my channel on Pantheon Podcasts and thearwenlewisshow.com.
Hi, this is Peter Lewis of Moby Grape. You're listening to The Arwen Lewis Show.